Jai Jai Vithala Shri Hari Vithala. So here in the last section, we saw that the seeker, the devotee, he must give up, not only surrender all the actions to the Lord, but also and chant the name of the Lord, remember the Lord while doing all actions, but also abhivanam adambikam tyajyam, he must give up the abhiman, the pride, the vanity, the arrogance, and not only that, tadarpita akhilacharah san kama krodha abhimanadikam tasmin eva karani. He must also give up kama krodha lova moha madha matsarya, anger, greed, jealousy, envy, hypocrisy, pride, arrogance, all these at the feet of the Lord. There is no way that the individual personality, the identified consciousness can ever give these up, because these are the what you call chare ko kya bolte hai,
fodder.
This is the fodder for the I, the individual. Anger, greed, jealousy, because this is what is keeping it intact. And how can that which is keeping you intact, you will give up? You will not. Until unless that same I realizes that there is something greater than these, and that is the love for the Lord. And once that love is inculcated within the heart, such a devotee, knowingly, consciously, and later on unconsciously, is offering everything. Why unconsciously? Now his devotion has reached such a peak that he is not even aware that these type of thoughts are erupting within his mind, because everything is getting offered to the feet of the Lord, into that altar of the love which is welling up in his heart. And in this way, such a devotee going beyond the three factors of experiences, love, consisting of constant service. What are these three factors? I missed out on that in the last verse, in the last, that is the 66th verse. The three factors of experience are the experiencer, the experienced, and the experiencing. The knower, known, knowing, the seer, seen, seeing, the taster, tasted, tasting, the hearer, hearing, heard and hearing. So these three factors are required for any experience to take place. And this devotee, as a result of his increased love intoxication towards the feet of his Lord, he is losing his all sense of these three triputi. These three triputi, experiencer, experience and experiencing, maintain the mind. And when these have vanished, then love alone remains, and that becomes, and that, how do you destroy these three? The example was given, like a servant who is devoted, dedicated and respectful towards his master and continues to serve only his master, doesn't think about anything else. His only thing is, how can I make my master more comfortable? What would my master like? I'll cook that for him. What will my master like? And he keeps thinking in this manner in order to serve. And so also the Nityakanta, the wife, not only she is dedicated, not only she is revering, but also she has the sense of position, the sense of love as an added emotion or faculty within her heart towards the master, towards her husband. And when a devotee starts feeling that way, that the Lord is mine, he has never been away from me. There has never been a moment that he has been away from me. Initially, Lord is somewhere and I am somewhere. I am the individual, God is the total. I am the teeny-meeny, God is the infinite. And I have to make efforts to get to the Lord. But as the triputi, as the triad of experiencer, experienced and experiencing, is the devotee, the Lord and the instruments through which he is remembering, all these are melting away because the mind is melting away in that infinite love. Even this sense that the Lord is other than me, initially these thoughts that Lord is mine, I am not other than him, and eventually the merging happens. And now in the 7th chapter, the topic is taken, what is the glory of this path of this great sage? Here it is told in the 67th verse, Sutra. Bhakta ekantino mukhyaha.
Bhakta ekantino mukhyaha.
Bhakta ekantino mukhyaha. So now here it is bringing us to a point where we are able to see the difference between who are these great devotees and who are the secondary devotees, the lower type of devotees. What is this higher devotion and this lower devotion which cuts a sage apart, cuts a realized master apart from everyone else? What is that special thing that is going on inside of them? What are their attitudes, etc.? So here he says that that divine love, what is this sage? Bhakta ekantino mukhyaha. Devotees whose sole single goal is the Lord himself and whose single pointed devotion towards the Lord is for his own, for its own sake, are the primary devotees. Who are these primary devotees? The saints and sages. Who are these primary devotees? Who do not have an identity of their own which is other than the Lord. Who are we who are having an identity and want to merge into the Lord? Who is this great devotee who is not seeing himself as other than the Lord by his grace? And such a devotee, he does not create a relationship between himself and the Lord, and therefore he is free. That mind which is now only of the nature of love where this Triputi is absent, there cannot be a relationship that I am the seer and that is the seen. I am the devotee and he is the devoted. I am the chanter and I am chanting his name. I am the rememberer and he is the remembered. I am the lover and he is the beloved. This separation is no longer there. He has lost all sense of relationship. And such a person, as this sense of relationship keeps diminishing, gets washed away in the floods of love that are coming out of his heart, slowly, slowly, such a devotee completely without a thought gets identified with his beloved, with this altar, in that love. This is just the language of speaking, that he gets identified. He alone is then afterwards. What would be the feeling that the wave is devoted towards the ocean and slowly, slowly, slowly it becomes the ocean? Right? It was already the ocean, no? Then what is that feeling that must be going through? That feeling is of the individuality. That individuality is melting away. Therefore, from relative standpoint, this is the language alone we can employ. So, he is free of all relationships and is getting merged into, totally identified with him, with no other, with nothing else to take his attention away, take his, there is nothing else for his mind to get identified with. Even though there is this whole world, but now by the grace, by this love, by this all-consuming love, he is seeing everything as that divine alone. There is no moment lost in that divinity, in that love, for any other special status to be maintained of anything or any being. And therefore, he merges into the Lord or he keeps remembering the Lord. And how is he remembering? Please make me one with you. No, he has got no demands. He has got no requests. He has got no desire also of the liberation, which an initial seeker or an initial devotee, with that thought he begins, isn't it? Even that also is not there. Now you see in the Vedanta, even that desire, intense desire for liberation, which is one of the qualifications, even that desire has to be given, isn't it? But when can you give up? Right in the beginning? No, only when you are deep in contemplation of the truth and there is no other theme in your mind. Same thing is happening here also. And therefore, these two paths are not different. Yes, sir?
When identification becomes second nature to him. Identification.
But he is not there anymore, so there is no second nature. Identification is only possible in the mind. When mind itself is not there, where is the question of second nature? Then such a person can only cry out, I and the Lord are one, Ana ul Haq.
So he would see, there is no separation, he won't even see that as I am, me and you are the Lord.
No, he can't. Yeah. You can't, he can't. Do you see yourself as separate to the body? We don't know, because the identification is so complete. And yet, the truth is body is separate. So we know how to be identified. Only the direction has to change. He becomes absolutely absorbed in it. He is desiring nothing, he is demanding nothing. And such a devotee, when a devotee has cultivated such type of devotion and reached its zenith, then such a devotee is called as the primary one. By whom? By others. He is not calling himself, I am the devotees, I am the best among the devotees. He doesn't say that. Now Narada says, says, such people, such devotees who demand nothing, desire nothing from the Lord, are totally identified with the Lord in the manner of speaking, free of all relationships, such alone are the ones who pursue the primary devotion to the Lord. This is the type of higher devotion. Meaning, they do not have, whose single-pointed devotion to the Lord is for its own sake. Not for union, not for any other purpose, except for the Lord's own sake. So, who are these? Certain qualities are given. Seven qualities are there. The first one is those who are devoted. Who are these primary devotees? The first point is those who are devoted towards the goal. What is the goal? God realization or being one with the God. Initially they begin that way. Then the second, and nothing can distract them from that. Second point is they are possessed of that all-consuming devotion within their heart, which is propelling them towards the goal that they have set for themselves. Third, it is bhakta ekantino mukhyaha, ekantino, ekantinaha is here taken as single-pointedness of the mind. And so they are single-pointed and not even one iota of their thought, meaning not even one iota of their energy is getting dissipated into unhealthy fields, unwanted fields. Their total being is for the goal that they have set for themselves, which is the Lord. Then the fourth one is without deviation from the one Lord. And here again, if you cultivate these qualities in yourself, even with regards to the world, it will be the same thing. Clear, devoted to one goal, possessed of all enveloping ambition or love for the project that you have started, not single-pointedly thinking about it and not getting deviated and distracted by anything else in the world, you will succeed, isn't it? Same qualities. So everything that spirituality is talking about is already that which we are practicing in our life. The only thing we are doing is we are applying it in the wrong area. You have to just take those things. One person asked me, I named his child and very close to me, and the wife, she said, Swamiji, you have to tell the name, you have to name the name. And eventually we looked at what would be the best, and the letter came out and the word came, the. Lot of names from the in for males, but for girls very less. Dhiraja. So eventually we named her Dhiya, the one very intelligent, with a pure intellect. And that person was going through, the boy was going through some difficulties. So he says, Swamiji, tell me something, how can I become successful? I'm trying everything, but it's not happening, it's not clicking. I said, you measure your success, or you combine your success to the success of your child. He says, what do you mean, success of the child? The child has come into the world, what is the success there? That child still has to study, go to school, go to uni, find a job, then success. I said, no, you look at that child. From the moment it is born, it is continuously become successful. It learns how to recognize, it learns how to move, it learns how to play, it recognizes you, it tries to speak, then within few months it will try to crawl, it will try to turn over, it will try to walk. Is that not success? From a total dependent child, the success of that child, it is becoming independent. I said, combine your success. Are you cultivating all the qualities that child has? Now see, what is going on in that child? Yes, it may be self-propelled, But you, because you are intelligent, you can see that I must cultivate that quality, I must cultivate that quality. You combine yourself with that, you will become successful. So also, without deviation of our mind from that one Lord whom we have taken to be as our goal, whether you do that or you take a teacher, some people choose a guru, some people choose a mantra, as long as these qualities are applied to that. Eklavya used his guru, he did not go to a god, isn't it? Prabhupada used Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare. And he just stayed with that mantra for all the time. Gora Kumbhar, one potter in Maharashtra, he did not know scriptures, nothing, not even allowed to get inside the temple. Can't even see the temple. See the Lord, not the temple, see the Lord. Not blind. He was not blind. Gora Kumbhar. Kumbhar means potter. So he was a potter. Not allowed. Only name on his lips was Vittala Vittala Jai Hari Vittala. And the Lord blesses him. I'll tell you a story afterwards.
He steps on his child.
Huh? Did he? Okay. Yeah, he did. Don't spoil it. It's the same one, yes. Yeah, the movie. Videos are there. On YouTube, you can see all these great masters' videos. The technology has one advantage. My only pastime is not all these. I just go into my room whenever I'm tired of everything, then I just find some nice saints movie, Shankaracharya's, Gajanan Maharaj, Tukaram, Tulsi Das, Gora Kumbhar, Swata Mali, Chokhamala, Sant Jnaneshwar. So many movies are there. And you look at that.
It's in Hindi,
No, Marathi. But if you get DVDs from India, you can get with the English subtitle. But on YouTube, there is no subtitle. No? So, and lastly, the one who is not distracted by any temptations in his life. Distraction from temptation. Not getting distracted by temptation is only possible when that love is flowering in and expanding in intensity. Temptations will come. Even to such a person like Gora Kumbhar, temptations came. But when I tell you the story, you will see what he did. But he did not succumb to them. Because the moment you succumb to those temptations, immediately individuality is concretized. So there must be a temptation in all great masters to heal themselves. They can, but they keep it at bay. No, I want to maintain this all-pervasive love in my heart. I don't want to use that pervasive love, that potent love, to heal myself, because the moment myself word comes into the mind, my body comes into the mind. My body comes into the mind, you become an ice block. Same infinite consciousness, it takes hardly a second, not even a microsecond, to get concretized. How much time does it take the infinite waters to become a wave? How much time it takes for a wave to become the infinite waters? Hardly anything. How much time does it take you to become a mother when you look at the child and to become a daughter when you look at your parents? That quick it takes for us, for this consciousness to concretize as I. And therefore, we must keep surrendering everything. So this highest type of devotee, he is the exclusive type, Ananya Bhakta. He is not confused about anything in his sadhana. He is very clear what the goal is and what are the various steps and how to, that what does it mean of love expanding in his heart. He understands all that. From where does the understanding come? From the Lord. He has not studied any scriptures. He is just focused on that one infinite Lord. And in this way, as he keeps progressing towards his destination of the Lord, eventually that love that is expanding in his heart itself is his fulfillment of this devotee. And he does not want liberation, he does not want union, he does not want healing, he does not want to change the world, nothing. He says, let thy will prevail. I am just going to remember you. And that itself is mukti for a devotee. That itself is liberation. Union or no union. The mental attitude of such a great devotee in their moments of fulfillment is being told in the 60th verse. What are the symptoms? Here it is told, Kanthavarodha Romancha Shrubhihi Parasparam Lapamanaha Pavayanti Kulani Prithivimcha. So actually it is, okay, anyway. Kanthavarodha Romancha Shrubhihi Parasparam Lapamanaha Pavayanti Kulani Prithivimcha. When they, with their throats choked with emotion, body covered with horripilation, and tears flowing down, converse with each other in broken words, they sanctify their family and tribe, nay, the very earth itself, they come to glorify. Who? Such sages, such saints, such devotees of the Lord. The joy of love, as it is expanding itself within his heart, they get intoxicated in that love, where they lose all sense of time, space and objectivity. And as such a person is in that remembrance of the Lord or remembering his glories, you go to listen to sometimes the Harikatha. What is not making you go back home right now? What is it?
Love.
Is it, my word, why go back home again? The hell will break loose. Is that the thought? Is it that I have to, once I go again, I have to go for shopping, I have to go and this, my children will ask this, my children will ask that, my husband will demand this, I have to start vacuuming, the kitchen will be in a mess. Better stay here. Swamiji, can we extend it for 1 week? This is not devotion. This is not devotion. This is not devotion. Then what is it? What is that which is keeping us? Sometimes when we are in the class at home, when we are listening to that Amrut Anubhav, when I am speaking about it, you are listening, when we are listening to some story of the saint, what is that? Where you become so alert, so heightened concentration comes. Without any, you have not done any tratak or any yoga or anything, but you become so alert, so vigilant. You don't want to miss even one single word. What is that? That is intoxication. That is remembrance of the Lord. When you don't want to come out of the silence after the bhajan, intoxication does not mean just aha, woohoo, and you know, there's one intoxication or drugs and drinks. But this silence is also intoxicating. But the conch, as much as the inert silence is intoxicating, so much so, imagine without knowing the silence has such a great effect on our on us. Imagine if we were conscious of that silence, how much more effect it will be. And therefore we all want silence. But what do? We want silence and we start trying to get silence. We start doing things to get silence. And doing will create more cacophony in the mind, not silence. So these devotees, these great lovers of the Lord, those who are intoxicated in the love of the Lord, such kanthavarodha romancha shrubihi, kanthavarodha, when they speak of the Lord, when they come across each other, their throat, in that intoxication, in that chanting, the words don't come out of their mouth. They're choking away. They want to sing. Because what happens in that moment? This must have happened to you also. When you love someone and you want to hug someone, you are nonplussed. What do I say? बस प्यार की झपकी देनी है बस मेरे को समझ नहीं आता व्हाट कम 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 बट व्हाट इज न्यू दैट इज नॉट लव यू आर ट्राइंग टू एक्सप्रेस समथिंग यू वांट टू एक्सप्रेस लव बट आउट व्हाट इज कमिंग आउट व्हाट इज दैट एट दैट मोमेंट व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इज दिस इनफाइनाइट लव has to express through this finite body, through this finite mind. And the body is screaming, I can't handle the infinite to express through. The mind is screaming, I cannot handle the infinite to express through. The throat is screaming, I cannot handle the infinite to express through. The eyes, the ears, they are screaming because they are incapable of handling the infinite, because they are born out of the finite, and therefore kanthavarodho, the throat chokes, the eyes start crying, the body, out of the pain, the exhaustion of remembrance of the Lord, the studies of the Lord, the chanting of the Lord, it starts giving up, it becomes shithil. And in that sense of giving up, exhaustion, suddenly from there, in that body, waves of ecstasy start, because giving up is required in order for ecstasy to express. If you hold on, I am the body, I have to keep the back straight, I have to do this, I have to do that. But you have to keep trying. But at the same time, you have to know that it is only in giving up that the salvation lies. And who is going to give up? You don't have to try and give up. The Lord will take it away. And at that time, when the Lord takes away, he sees, array, the instrument is available fully. There is no one to say, no one to block my exit or entry through this instrument. Yahoo! And when that Yahoo moment comes, horripilations, ecstasy, tears, choking voice. It may happen for few seconds, few minutes, but eventually all that takes the devotee into silence. See? These are the symptoms. Kantha varodha romancha ashrubihi parasparam lapamanaha. Parasparam lapamanaha, conversing in broken words. Can't make out what he is saying. Why? The words are choking away. No language is capable of expressing. We already used the word. It is inexpressible. It is incommunicable. this divine love. So at that time, what will he use? Whatever comes out. Pavayanti kulani prithvimcha, and such a sage, wherever he is, the earth itself feels blessed by the presence of such a saint or a sage standing on it. That place gets sanctified. Therefore, Jerusalem. Therefore, Bodh Gaya. You came to Bodh Gaya? You came?
Mm-hmm.
Where Buddha was born?
Yes,
oh,
yes,
he realized
yes,
that tree?
Yes,
you came there?
Yes.
You, so, why that has become so famous? Why do you feel such energy emanating from that place? Why do you go to Tiruvannamalai? 30 kilometers away from Ramana Ashram. You enter into that whole area, whether you are in a bus, whether you are in a train, whether you are in a car, whether you are walking or a cycle, something shifts. Something shifts. You feel that you have come into a sanctified area. You have been? Have you been? Oh, you have to go. In this life, you must go to Tiruvannamalai. Must. Go there, on email, book your rooms in Ramana Ashram itself and enjoy a nice 15 days, 1 month there. One of them, you go in there, don't go there to socialize and see who all are there. No, you just go there, go to his bedroom, go to his samadhi place, go to the caves where he used to meditate. In the morning, in the samadhi room where the aarti takes place, in the afternoon, in his bedroom, in the evening when the dusk is happening, go for a nice walk up the hill, not very high, and stay in the cave, take a bottle of water, spend 2-3 hours there, come down at lunch, dinner time, and go to. Oh, beautiful. Why Tiruvannamalai has been become famous? Why Shirdi has become famous? Why Shegaon has become famous? Why Akkalkot has become famous? Why Puttaparthi has become famous? Why Vallikav has become famous? Not because these places did not exist before, but they have become places of pilgrimage because saints lived there. Because that same girl came to realize the ultimate, was able to, was experiencing that intoxicating love for the Lord in that Vallikav, the fish village, fishing village. Now that place is not a fishing village anymore, it's a place of pilgrimage. Akkalkot, an indescribable place on the border of Maharashtra and Karnataka. Hardly anyone will go. But now a pilgrimage center. Why? The great sage, Dattatreya Avatar, Akkalkot Maharaj, you came with us for that. So that is what is told here, that the very earth itself is purified by their presence and becomes, that ground becomes the holy ground. We must go to these pilgrimage places where going to temples is okay, but going to those places where someone like us, someone with two hands, two legs and a head on top, was born like us through the womb of a mother, was living in the same world, was able to inculcate that love for the Lord and was able to be one with Him. When you go to these places, a great inspiration comes. And it is not that such people, they go, they are there and oh God, no, they have got no doubt whatsoever. As this love expands and they lose their sense of I, that this mind is still there, that this this Lord and me, we are not separate. I am that. When the mind clicks in again, there is no question of that, no doubt about that. That I am infinite, and because I am infinite, I cannot be identified only to one body. And in this way, those who have discovered this infinite love, this infinite principle, the Lord within their own hearts, and this can happen only by the grace, not by your own will. And when they discover, what happens is, kantha varodha romancha ashrubihi parasparam tapamanaha pavayanti kulani prithvimcha, that they get choked. They want to express to the people, they want to share with others what they are feeling in their own hearts, but they are incapable to. And in this way, when you wear a shoe which is one size smaller than your foot, and by mistake someone very nicely, lovingly brought it for you. Who brought it for you? That shoe is your body. Your parents brought it for you. And you entered it. Chalo, let's start walking. Initially it is okay. But slowly, 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 as you grow or as you walk, that tight shoe starts hurting because you are growing. Now that small shoe cannot. So that shoe, what will happen? Eventually it will tear, isn't it? That tearing of that shoe is the breaking up of this body identification. As the infinite is trying to express this shoe called the body, it cannot handle. It has to give way. The seams break apart. And that breaking apart of the seams of the body is this horripilation, is this ecstasy, is this choking voice, is this crying, tears coming out of your, out of the eyes. Where even he is available to the whole world, but his ears are only listening to the divine. That's all there is. And by such a master, by such a devotee, the whole world is blessed. There is no question about it. And the glory of such a sage who is merged in devotion is totally lost the sense of time and space and objectivity. Tirthi kuruvanti tirthani. Sukarmi kurvanti karmani. Sa shastri kurvanti shastrani. Tirthi kurvanti tirthani. Sukarmi kurvanti karmani. Sa shastri kurvanti sat shastri kurvanti shastrani. Such devotees, they sanctify the sacred places of pilgrimage, add glory to actions, and lend authority to the scriptures. We go to a temple is not a temple. A temple is not a temple where saints and sages have not put their feet, who have not come and bless that temple, not bless the Lord, bless the building by their presence. A house is not a house if people are not living in the house, isn't it? So always rent the house, otherwise it will get broken down. As long as it's getting used, then it remains, everything remains intact. Yes, you have to keep few repairs. Similarly, a temple, how does Lord, who is there in the statue, who is appearing there as a statue, how does he manifest? How does he, how is his vibrations caught by the common masses? Only when great saints and sages come and visit that temple. Only when a common man chanting that name of that divine Lord comes to realize that divine Lord in that temple, immediately the whole sanctity of the temple changes. Yeah? Why? What's the difference? Swamiji, here I am able to meditate for 2 hours without any problem. Mind is so calm. Why am I not able to do it at home? Why? That's also a building. This is also a building. What is the difference? Then that person comes to the class. Then in the class, he says, I am able to meditate here very easily. Without any efforts, my mind goes into meditation, but at home it doesn't go into meditation. Why?
Attachment to your home.
Not just attachment. Here also it is attachment only.
Sanctity.
Auspiciousness. Auspiciousness. So, because the feeling is there in him that so many years the classes have been taken, satsang is going on, so it is a holy place. We also feel like coming here. Some places you go, you don't feel like going and conducting class there, isn't it? But here we come, why? We feel at home. We feel very comfortable. We feel nothing is going to distract us. The vibrations are very nice, positive. Initially it is good. But if you keep depending upon a building for vibrations, keep depending upon the statue for vibrations, keep depending upon the scriptures for vibrations, then gone. The recognition must be from within. So here it is told that such a person, sukarmi kurvanti karmani, that deep devotion, their intoxicated love which they are experiencing within their bosom, such people go and move around in the world. And when they move around in the world, they continue. They don't become lazy. They go and bring about a positive change. Jnaneshwar Maharaj wrote commentary on the Gita. He wrote commentary on his own experience, the Amrut Anubhav. He went and gave lectures wherever there was an opportunity, he gave lectures. He initiated so many. I'm talking about Gora Kumbhar, I'm talking about Swata Mali, I'm talking about Namdev Mahar. All were initiated by him. Jnaneshwar Maharaj was their guru. All of them were there at his samadhi. And all of them used to meet together and sing gloriously day after day after day at Pandharpur. So it is not a person who has felt the love. Just a simple example, you see a nice movie, do you stop? Acha, I'll keep it a secret to myself. No, you immediately, very next opportunity you come, oh, that was fantastic, man. I must tell this person, he will enjoy that or she will enjoy that. Then you go for dinner, you go to work, you meet some other people, and because that is there, it has created such a great impact on your mind, involuntarily, everywhere, you become the natural advertiser of that movie. You have not decided, you have not thought that you will tell so many people, but it just comes out of you. Have you seen that Matrix? Have you seen that movie? Have you seen that movie? Oh, you must see it. Just like I told you, have you been to Thiruvanmalai? Automatic advertiser, isn't it? Have you read that text? Have you been to this place? Have you been to Pandharpur? Have you been to Akkalkot? Have you been to Thiruvanmalai? Have you been to Kailash? It's automatic. It's not that you are trying to get anything out of it. What am I going to get by you going there? No, but it's, you can't contain yourself. So also, if this is so true in our daily living, why only these holy places? Even if a nice restaurant we find, we keep advertising it. Free publicity for him, isn't it? Or if we find a sale going on somewhere, immediately mom gets all the calls. Ah, there the dal is $2 cheaper. There the rice is $2 cheaper. Go buy, bring it. Why? You can't contain. Ah, I'm getting a bargain. Imagine then such a master, such a devotee in whose mind, who has experienced the grace of the divine, how can he stop from advertising it? How can he stop himself from sharing it with others? He becomes the divine messenger of Lord for all the humanity. Whatever the capacity, he goes left, right, center, north, south, east, west, wherever inspiration takes him. He does not decide that I'm going to do this or I'm going to do that. He goes spreading the word of the Lord. Shirdi Baba didn't go anywhere. Shirdi Sai Baba didn't go anywhere. Satya Sai Baba also didn't go anywhere. But Vivekananda went everywhere. Chinmayananji went everywhere. Ammachi goes everywhere. How it expresses, that is not their concern. But they cannot stop. They are unable, incapable of stopping this surge of love and inspiration pouring out of them. And such people, Tirthi Kurvanti Tirthani, they make the places of pilgrimage like Badrinath, like like Pandharpur, like Tirupati, all these places become even more sanctified because of these great masters. You go there, Badrinath, the moment you hear, you know Badrinath, you read the story, you know, the sages Nar and Narayan meditated here. And this mountain on which the Badrinath temple is the Narayan sage and the other one is the Nar. Horibapre. And then you walk a little bit further, then, oh, this is the cave where Maharishi Vedvyas used to live. Oh, really? And you go inside and believe me, you will feel that peace and tranquility inside that cave. And with so much love, that priest there, he is telling you the story of the whole, how this came about. He must have told it to millions of people by now. But he does not get tired. With the same joy, with the same tears in his eyes, with the same inspiration, sitting in that cave where his head has to be like this because the ceiling is not very high. He sits there. Everyone who comes in, he tells the story, he gives them a little bit of Saraswati water as a blessing. What is it that does not make him tired? It's the same story. See? So because these three people have been there, now when I tell you about Badrinath to someone, I say, as I was telling you, I met that person, Hanuman Baba, who always lived, he did 108 pradakshinas of the temple, circumambulation of the temple. You haven't met him. Again, he's missing. Last time I went here, I couldn't find him. Then there was this lady who was a princess who came to Badrinath and became a great saint. In Vrindavan, I have his photograph. I'm sure he has passed away now. He has taken samadhi. Swami Satyananda Saraswati in Vrindavan. Huh? He came from Kerala and he was roaming around everywhere. And one day, While he was roaming around all over the country, he came to Vrindavan. And when he came to Vrindavan, as usual, he was a Parivrajaka. Parivrajaka means not staying in one place for more than 3 days. Like our Anubhavananji. He is not in 3 days, but he does not move more than a week. Keep moving. When he left Vrindavan, Krishna said, why have you left me? Why have you gone? And from somewhere, somehow, he got a statue of a Krishna. Very beautiful statue in black marble or shaligram, something like that. And he came. And when he came, then he came back to Vrindavan, and he was again roaming around, no place to live, this, that. And one day, his statue got stolen. But thief took it away. Why? Because he was sleeping on the veranda outside the house, keeping the Krishna next to him. Someone stole. From the moment that he realized that his statue had been stolen, he became like fish out of water. Krishna, where are you? Krishna, where are you? He had never felt this before in his life. And he started screaming, crying, running around the streets, asking everyone, have you seen my Krishna? Have you seen my Krishna? Nobody was able to. Then when his body got exhausted, crying and writhing on the floor, where? Went to temple, where are you? Where are you? He was so attached to that Krishna statue. Maybe we say that. Maybe he was attached to the Krishna himself within his heart. But then a voice spoke inside his, yeah, I will come, but if you give me a promise. He says, what is the promise? You will never leave Vrindavan. No more Parivrajaka business. And he gave a promise to him that I will not leave Vrindavan. And he lived there on that main street in one of the houses. And just by chance, someone took me there, and he never, if you go to his into his room, on the next to his table, like this table, it says, if you understand my silence, you will understand God. That is the statement written there. If you understand the silence, you will understand God. He will not speak to anyone. Except between 6 and 6:30, you can go and visit him. Whole day he is in silence. Hardly talks, maybe to his workers and those people who are helping him. Old man now. And if in that between 6 and 6:30, if he gives you fruits and if he gives you prasad, understand, you have to leave, you can't stay. Over, time is over. Do your namaskar, go. That statue came back to him. Every great vakta, speaker, who comes to Vrindavan, every satsang that happens in Vrindavan, those who know, or like Ramesh Bhai Oja and others, when they go there and they give, they are talking to thousands, 10,000, 20,000 people. But before they speak, they go to Satyanand Saraswati Ji, take his blessings. He does not give any lecture. Many people don't even know that he is there. Or they have taken it for granted that hai next door. And when I went, I was sitting next to him and he held my hand, and I started, itna maja aa gaya, and then I started pressing his feet. He says, kyun itna pyar kar rahe ho? Maine kaha, Swami ji, aap ho hi aise. So I kept doing. He said, ha bolo. Then he told everyone to go. So I was also getting, nahi tum baitho. He made me sit down. He did not allow me to go. Then he says that, tomorrow what time you are coming? I said, what time would you like me to come? He says, you are a Veda, you have studied just now the scriptures, isn't it? So a lot of questions are there in your head. You come at 1 o'clock. No, you come at 11 o'clock. So 11 to 12 we will spend the time, and then I have to take food and then I will rest. And then you come again at 3 o'clock and we'll have some special time, just time between us, between 3 and 6, and then afterwards people can come. For 1 week, 2 weeks, I had that opportunity with him. Just sit there and spend that time. I'll show you his photograph in the next class. I have it here. I was just looking at it and I was remembering. I am not known to him. Never any idea. And one day, I had gone to him and he says, I just went quickly. I said, Swamiji, pranam, and I can't stay. You may not want to stay, but let's see what Krishna's wish is. Day after tomorrow is Radha Ashtami, and come, there is going to be a bhandara. Swamiji, I've got to do this, I've got to do that. I don't think I'll be able to come. And I had forgotten. I left from there, I forgot, I went to Delhi one day in between before Radha Ashtami, and on the day of Radha Ashtami, whole morning I'm feeling, Swamiji said that I have to come, but kya yaar, itna 140 kilometers, sit in the bus, go through the dust, this, that, nahi jayenge. And before I knew, at 3 o'clock, I was in a bus going towards Vrindavan, and I got down there, and the moment I came into the building, Swamiji was waiting. He says, I told you, you will come. And the boys who were taking care of the kitchen and for the bhandara of all the people who had come, his devotees had come, he said, Swamiji told us in the afternoon only that to keep some food for you because you are coming. Such love brings tears to your eyes. Itna concern. And he was awake. Normally he goes to sleep quick. I reached there at around 8:30. He said, Swamiji is still awake, he is waiting for you. Went up, pressed his feet. That time he was 84, 86. Pressed his feet and he just touched my hands and everything, put his hand over my head. Kya ho gaya? I said, kuch nahi hua. Aap mere ko rula rahe ho. So, kehte hain, acha hai, rolo. Aaj din acha hai, Radha Ashtami. When this feeling, what we are feeling right now, comes towards the entire world, every being that comes into our life, every experience that comes into our life, every incident, every contact, then life is fulfilled. And it is not something that you can make it happen. All you can do is feel this love in your heart and remain focused on it. Then alone it will happen. This metamorphic change will take place within yourself. That's when such a place where this Satyananda Saraswati, yes, Krishna was there. Who has seen? We have not seen. But Akhandananda Saraswati, Udiya Baba, that Langoti Wale Baba, he used to live only in his langoti on the banks of the Yamuna river in Vrindavan. He'll sleep only on the sand. And if you go close to him, he'll throw stone at you. Get away from here. Tall fellow. Some jat was there. Great person. Only once I could meet him. And everyone is waiting outside the door, outside the gates. Chalo yaar, andar chalte hain. Tum jao, patthar. You go, see if that stone comes. If he's not hitting the stone, then we'll come. Everyone is trying to push someone forward. So why is Vrindavan important? Yes, Krishna was born. But who knows Vrindavan of that time and Vrindavan of today? The river has changed course for so many times over the last 2,000-3,000 years, 5,000 years. So what is making that place so sanctified, so blessed? It is the coming of these great saints and sages. It is the words of these saints and sages that this is the place which gives it a confirmation that this is the place. Tirthi kurvanti tirthani, sukarmi kurvanti kurvani. So just as pilgrimage places became a place of pilgrimage because and become sanctified and blessed because of the appearance of such devotees in those places, so also whatever actions the great devotees do in their life, those actions become sanctified. If they build a temple, if Shankaracharya has built the Badrinath, he was instrumental in it. He built the Kedarnath temple. He built the Tirupati temple. He built so many temples all over the country. He organized the four Shankaracharya Math, the places of learnings. So when such a person does something, it works. The quality of, we try doing so many things in our life. Some things work, some things don't. Isn't it? Why? There is a will, there is a desire. But when such a devotee does something, it is not his individual desire. It is the Lord functioning through him and making it happen. And therefore, the action, here, sukarmi kurvanti kurvani, su means auspicious. Whatever actions they do, it becomes auspicious. If that Akkalkot Swami, you see his movie, I got the movie at home. He used to throw stones, he used to abuse people. But people used to feel very blessed. If that stone comes and hits, the problems are gone. That Swami Nityanand Saraswati of Ganeshpuri, just outside Bombay, he was playing one day with the children and once they were hitting him stones. Are Nanga Baba again, Nanga Baba again, Nanga Baba. Tall, 6.5 feet tall, with a big tummy and walking around naked just with a langut, with an underwear, one piece of cloth, and threw stones at him. So he also, Manu Amavi, and one threw one stone not to hit them but to scare them away. He's like a child, and that stone went into a shop. That day, that shop did more business than it does in 1 month. It took some time for that business fellow, that shopkeeper, to realize that this is what has happened. Next day, when the Swami, that Nityananda was, Swamiji was going on the street, he said, please throw me one more stone. Like a small child, he did not, his attention is not on this, whether he is making business or making a lot. He said, hey, le. Again business. 2-3 days went. All others are not doing any business, this fellow is doing roaring business. So, what is happening? Why is he getting all the business? And then they notice this fellow is making this Mahatma to throw this stone. So they all started hitting him stones from the fourth day onwards, thinking that he will throw stone back at them. And they will also do business. Swamiji ran away, didn't come back up. See? So even their abuses, even their hitting, I've seen certain times it has happened that Mahatmas touch people and they say, "Arey yaar, how are you?" Arey, normally people say it on the shoulder or say it, do that lovingly on the head. Why did you do it on the bum? Why did you do it in the middle of the back? Or why did you do it on the just here? Haan, kaisa hai? But that one touch took the problem away. Swamiji, how did you know that I had a problem here? You touched, that's why it went away. They don't know. They're just being who they are. It's not that Baba is healing everyone. It's the faith with which is that same consciousness, infinite consciousness, which is making it all happen. So, sukarmi kurvanti karmani. So, if you have to do some work in the world, do it like the great masters. Make yourself capable like that. Make yourself to be a devotee like that, where you and the infinite, that distinction is no longer there. Then anything that comes out of you, any action that emanates from you, will be a holy action. Whether it is climbing the cross, whether it is being buried alive, whether it is this, who was this? Swatamali. Because he was chanting the name of the Lord, they found that Vitala, 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 Vitala is not coming. So Vitala said, let me test this fellow before I give him darshan. So what did he do? He put his armband, you know, the golden armband and the necklace, which was in the temple in Pandharpur. He put it there and he took his shawl. Overnight it happened. He didn't go there to the temple. Next day the priest came, he said, "Arey, whose shawl is this? And where are the Lord's ornaments?" And that time Pandharpur was small, they searched every house and they found it in his house. "Arey, he is the thief." So the people said, "Don't, he is a great master, this, that, Mahatma, he is always thinking of the Lord. We never saw him going out." No, but his shawl is on the Lord. That means he must have come and stolen the ornaments. They complained to the Nizam of that time. He said, he has to be a death sentence. And how is the death? That there is a spear and they will just put you on the spear and you die slowly. So he started chanting the name of the Lord. And the soldiers who are taking him, they want to get the job done quickly. They want to go back home and eat their chapati. So, quickly. And as the speed of the soldiers is increasing to take him to his death, he is chanting more forwardly. And when he reaches there, initially it is fear. It is the feeling that I am going to die. But just like Jesus also said, "Why have you forsaken me?" But the very next moment he is liberated. He is also afraid. But as he sees the inevitability of the moment, at that time he says, "Vithala, I am not afraid of death, but please make sure that instead of the pain, instead of the screaming, only you are there in my mind." And the moment he accepted the fact that spear, that huge metal spear on which he was going to be thrown, melted away. And the soldiers thought, what did this happen? Wonder of wonders. And they took the swords also melted away. The priest came running. He realized, "Arey, this is a great devotee." Took him, he was untouchable. Took him straight. "For you, there is no rules. You come inside the temple." Sat shastri kurvanti shastrani. The scriptures, if they are taught to people just as a textbook, they have got no meaning. But the scriptures have the sanctity, have so much reverence in our heart. Why? Because what is given in the scriptures has been realized by the great masters. That's why, isn't it? Why are we studying Narada Bhakti Sutra? Because it has been given to us by one of the greatest devotees of the Lord, the sage Narada himself, isn't it? That's why we are feeling that it is a great text to study and contemplate upon. Otherwise we wouldn't have taken it. Why do we study Upanishads? Because so many great masters, Shankaracharya has written on it, Shankaracharya realized it, other masters realized it. So who lends authenticity? Who lends the credibility to these scriptures? It is the saints and sages. When saints and sages say, "You must study for so many years Sai Baba did not talk about scriptures, isn't it? Scriptures means Brahman he did not talk about. He was saying only chant the mantra, sing the name of the Lord, everything. Then towards last 10 years I think, all the time, any lecture, after the lecture, you must study scripture. Brahman is the ultimate, you must contemplate on him, you must perfect yourself. Singing, winging is all okay, but at the same time, you have to study the scriptures also. Now, till he was not saying anything, nobody was doing it. They were busy singing. But when he started saying it, all his thousands and thousands and thousands of devotees, they started, nahin. So if Baba is saying Brahman is the goal, then we must also, who tells about Brahman? The scriptures. So we must study scriptures. Isn't it? Because he is saying it so. Because they have reverence for that great master. And that great master is qualifying the scriptures that what they are telling is the truth. If any other Tom, Dick and Harry on the street said, hey, read the scriptures. Tu kon hai bhai? Tu kis khet ki muli hai? Huh? You are the radish of which farm? Doesn't mean the same thing. Doesn't mean the same thing. Tu kis khet ki muli hai? Immediately the cord strikes inside. If this Mahatma says that, you chant Om Namah Shivaya and you chant, it will benefit you. But someone else says, you chant Sri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram. You start, nothing will happen. Why? Because that master who has given you the mantra, it is not the individual who has given you the mantra. Even if you think it is the individual who has given you the mantra, it is the devotee, the one who has realized Satya Sankalpa. That is the word. Such a master, when he speaks, whatever he speaks, it has to happen. Even if the bright sun is there and he says, oh, it is Swamiji, it is too hot, how can we have classes outside? He says, no, let's see what the Lord wishes, it might change, and it changes. If a devotee comes and says, Swamiji, I am blind since birth, please help me. If the devotion is intense and the divinity is moved, he does not even have to say anything. There have been cases. Ammaji, they took Ammaji's, one person was there with leprosy. In Singapore, and please heal me. She said, how many 3 days she's at any place? He said, no, just over indifferent. He kept coming every day. The moment he came, everyone ran away here there. Leprosy. The feeling is that it is contagious. And then somehow, I don't know the whole story. But he got the saliva of Ammaji and he applied it. Over leprosy from one moment to the next. Where is that? Now tell a scientist to work out what is the scientific formula behind this. her saliva, who is extremely diabetic, how her saliva was able to remove the leprosy? What is the scientific reason behind Baba giving vibhuti and the person getting healed? There is no logic. But in this day and age, everything, because the world lives in the manner of cause and effect. We have to understand everything is His grace alone. Everything. And make yourself available to His grace. So, sat shastri kurvanti shastrani. And in this way, the such few rare ones who lend authority to these scriptures Therefore, we come to study the scriptures. It is these people, sukarmi kurvanti karmani, they practice compassion, they practice, they show in their behavior kindness, they show goodness, they show tolerance, they show all these qualities. Therefore, we also want to cultivate those and we want to become like them, be like them. Because we are also tired of our inconsistencies in life. We also want to be nice. It's not that we want name and fame, that may be there. But if we see that these Mahatmas, they don't hanker after name and fame. Even if a person comes and abuses them, they still only have goodness for, think good about him. And all of us, somewhere deep in our heart, want to have these qualities. And how do we get? So, we must emulate, we must do what these Mahatmas are saying. They say, study the scriptures, so study the scriptures. If they say, take the mantra, do the mantra. If they say, pray, do this work, then do that work. No question of ego coming in. And in this way, why do such sages add authority to the very divine scriptures themselves? That topic is stretched forward in the next section, and the glory of the perfected, we'll see that in our next class. Once there was this potter, and this potter was with his wife, and he had a small child. And this small child, the wife, and this potter, what he used to do? He used to, when you have to knead the mud to make it soft, only then you can use it for the potting purposes. So he had a small place and he used to jump on it. With his feet he used to break it down. And he will stand like Vitthala. And he will keep jumping and keep jumping, and with every step, Vitthala, 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 Vitthala. And he used to be transported in divine intoxication. And one day his wife said, Gora, I'm going away. I put the milk on the gas. On the gas, I'm saying, on the stove. So please take care. He said, okay. But as she's also foolish, because she knows he will not take care. Well, he's chanting the name of the Lord. He does not have any sense. Gone. Few days pass by. One day she has to go. There's no water in the house. She says, I'm going to get the water from the well. This child is there on the in the courtyard, and in the courtyard itself he was making all the pots and everything. She thinks the child will be fine. He's saying, Gora, take care, huh? He's just there. Vitthala, 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 Vitthala. The child goes, starts crawling here and there, and he is so intoxicated in his remembrance of the Lord that fervently he is jumping around on the mud. And somewhere, somehow, that child, attracted by his father's, he can't speak or anything, but he comes to the father where he is and falls into that mud. And where, when, how, he gets trampled under his feet and gets mixed in the entire mud. And the wife comes, looks for the child. Where is the child? Where is the child? Where is the child? Then looks at the mud. She sees blood in the mud. And from then onwards, she says, don't you dare touch me anymore, you murderer. He says, okay. Few days pass, few months pass. She's feeling the pining that I want to have a child. He says, no, I'm not touching. Vitthala, Vitthala, Vitthala. He does not even touch her, because she has told her not to touch me. So the wife gets very frustrated. She says, what to do? What is this family life? that husband is not touching me, there is no child, okay, he has made a mistake, what to do? Then she thinks, there's another idea. She takes her husband to her father. She has got a younger sister. She says, you get married to my younger sister. And from her, they will have a child in the house. So the father, while giving the daughter to the Gora Kumbhar, he says, please treat her just like your first wife. He says, okay. He doesn't touch her also. Now both of them are frustrated, family life, and the husband is not touching us. And one day they come up, they concoct a plan. What they do, the Gora is sleeping in the middle, and both of them are sleeping on both sides. Each one of them take one arm and put his fingers to touch them, to show when he gets up that you touched us, now you're the vow is broken, now you can sleep with us. The moment he wakes up and he sees that his hands are touching them, he feels, they say, now, and they become very happy. But very next moment he goes and chops off all his fingers. Because I will not touch. I only want Pitthala. No question of pain. It has to be done. Then one day he is going into the temple, and there in the temple he is chanting as usual, Vithala, 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 going on. He is not able to satisfy his wives. They go in, they take him with him. The last solace is Lord Vithala. So they go into the temple, and there, as he is going towards the temple, you came to Vithala temple, no? Yeah, Maharashtra tour we went. Remember when we were sitting in the corridor, courtyard outside? And then that person came, we paid some money, we got the ticket, and we got a VIP entry, and we could hug the Lord.
Yes.
That is Vithala, that is Krishna. The whole crowd stopped, till all of us, we could hug the Lord as long as we wanted. Grace. And he is coming in the queue, and he is chanting Vithala, 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 Vithala. Jai Hari Vittala, Shri Hari Vittala, Jai Hari Vittala, Shri Hari Vittala. At that time, Jnaneshwar Maharaj, Namdev Maharaj, Janabhai, and all these other saints, they are sitting on the other side of the temple in the courtyard, and they are singing. And as they are singing, their chanting is reaching in ecstasy, and Gora Kumbhar, as he is coming closer to the statue, he is becoming ecstatic. When he is becoming ecstatic, all these saints, they say, who is this? They even increase, and the whole temple is reverberating with the sound of Shri Hari Vittala, Jai Hari Vittala, 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 Jai Vittala. And it is going on and on and on, and at that time when he goes and hugs the Lord, lo behold, something magic happens. His fingers come back. By whose grace? By the Lord's grace. And the moment the wife see that their husband's fingers have come back, Lord, please tell him to take his vow away. But Lord has found one great devotee. He is not going to let go of his devotee. He says, he understands what the wife wants. What is paining her? What is paining her is the death of her child. The Lord, there and then, from the statue, the lost child who was dead came out and came into the arms of Gora Kumbhar's wife. And from then on, he became one of the party members of Jnaneshwar and the party. And this way, it is not just knowing that we have to have devotion, you have to cultivate devotion, you have to expand the love Devotion is not just a word, it is the feeling of love within your heart. And it needs to expand on moment to moment, day by day basis. And the only way we can do it is by feeding it. How do you feed it? By directing it towards the divine. While directing it towards the divine, yes, whatever distractions are there, whatever the impediments are there, they will be there. No matter what you are doing, you keep surrendering them at the feet of the Lord. The more you surrender them at the feet of the Lord, the more your love will expand. And somewhere along the way, a new way of living will be inaugurated in your life, which is not a willful way. But now it's a way of the way Lord wants it. You find yourself, situations are the same, difficulties are the same, circumstances are the same. Still, someone will come and take you as a saint, another person will come here and take you as a thief. But you do not react to anything. Why? Your mind is not available to it. Your mind is only with the divine theme. And slowly, 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 all these things, you see the Shirdi Baba story, for so 30, 40 years he was there in Shirdi, yet after 40 years, so many people in Shirdi did not believe that he was a great master. After 40 years, only few people believed in Shirdi. More people from outside believed and came to visit him. See? So this way, don't sell yourself short in this life thinking that you have duties to perform, that you have chores to do, that you have to survive in this world. No. The only dharma, the only duty we have, the purpose because of which we have been born as a human being, is to merge into the divine, to realize that divine. Everything else can wait. Initially, yes, it will feel that you are not doing your duties, etc. But if your love towards the divine increases, it encompasses everything. Everything will be taken care of. Just like that Janabai. The Lord came and did all the chores of the house. Now you don't remember the Lord because you want to get good food every day. If you do it, it will happen also. But that is not our goal. Our goal is to merge into the Lord. So through this, what we have been doing throughout, every time some incident of some saint I am telling, is so our mind remains soaked in these stories of these great masters, who, as rightly in these last few verses, that they lend authority, credence to the scriptures, they make the holy places even more holier, and their actions express divinity while they are performing. And divinity is nothing but empathy, compassion, kindness, love, acceptance of everyone without any caste, creed or color. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harih Om Shri Gurubhyo Namah. Harih Om.
Jai Hari Vitthala, Shri Hari Vitthala. Jai Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal, Jai
Hari Vittal,
Jai Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal,
Jai
Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal, 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 Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Vittal, Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Vittal, 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 Shri Hari Vittal, Jai Hari Vittal.
ज्ञानेश्वर महाराज की जय निवृत्तिनाथ महाराज की जय नामदेव महाराज की जय जनाबाई महारानी की जय गोरा कुंभार की जय विठ्ठल भगवान की जय